About half a year ago, I posted a video where I tried computing really large Fibonacci numbers, and my language of choice was C++. By the end, I surpassed the 4 millionth Fibonacci number in just under a second. The video was, to my surprise, very well received. Nonetheless, there was a noticeable population of commenters who took the video as a challenge and proceeded to decimate my meager 4 million in a variety of languages. These commenters were quite respectful and sportsmanlike, despite rendering my 30-minute monologue completely moot. That being said, I thought to myself, if it's so easy for everyone to beat me, who's to say I can't beat me as well? After careful consideration, I decided to play the optimization game again, but this time, I was going to do it in C. And off I went, laying the groundwork for this endeavor and announcing it in a video with a not-at-all clickbaity title. And boy, did that ever open Pandora's box. You could say that the last video inspired a handful of passionate responses. Some people were really gunning for my self-esteem, trying to make me feel stupid for how I massacred their favorite programming language. Unfortunately for them, I'm a mathematician. I always feel stupid. That being said, if you really want to leave a deep cut in someone's self-esteem, follow the show-don't-tell rule. For example, instead of saying, "Wow, this guy can't be bothered to learn proper C++ move semantics and thinks switching to C is going to magically make things better," try something more like this. Around 8 minutes and 57 seconds in, the C++ Chad claims that the temporary variable is moved into B because its value is no longer used at that point, but that's completely incorrect. You don't even need GDB or to read assembly to see it. You just need some well-placed debug statements. And then, when you run the program, you'll see immediately that the program is littered with expensive data copies, including the copy of temp into B. It's clear that G didn't do his due diligence and was making baseless guesses about how C++ compiles. For this, G deserves all the vitriol thrown his way. Either way though, the haters are right. My original Fibonacci codebase is fraught with poor performance decisions due to misunderstanding the inner workings of C++. This leads to another important life lesson. You're not a C++ compiler. Well, I really mean I'm not a C++ compiler, but, you know, it's the royal you, so it's all fine. As mentioned in my previous video, I've opted to switch to C in favor of its simplicity, so that what I write has more deliberate effect on the assembly output. Before you ask me why I don't just write assembly directly, ask yourself, do you really think I could make peephole optimizations in x86 better than a mature C compiler? Last time, we left off at the simple linear implementation, which is a quadratic time algorithm that is capable of computing past the 600,000th Fibonacci number in under a second, when I wrote it in C. Next in line is to restructure the naive iteration loop with fast exponentiation. I've already explained the algorithm in the first video, but as a brief overview, remember that the nth Fibonacci number can be computed by taking the nth power of a certain 2x2 matrix. This is beneficial because we can compute the nth power of anything using O of log n multiplications. Even with my poor C++ design decisions, this algorithm takes us past the 800,000th Fibonacci number. But don't be fooled. Just as our linear algorithm isn't actually linear, this fast exponentiation algorithm isn't logarithmic either, thanks to the non-trivial cost of multiplication. For simplicity, I'm just going to work with grade school multiplication for now, which grows quadratically with the number of digits of its factors. We've worked out already that the fast exponentiation algorithm turns out to be quadratic in the index, which we can see by looking at the heights of each of these steps in the runtime plot. These jumps in the runtime happen precisely at powers of 2, since these trigger a new multiplication step in the algorithm. In the C++ implementation, you'll notice that I wrote a general 2x2 matrix multiplication function, but as I mentioned before, there's no reason to be more general than the intended application. In the context of computing Fibonacci numbers, the only matrices we ever see are symmetric, so a general purpose 2x2 matrix multiplication will always do redundant work in this case. In particular, we can instead work with three-dimensional vectors with an interestingly defined product. At a high level, the algorithm looks pretty much the same as we've already seen. However, as I've said in the previous video, the devil's in the details. This is a YouTube video. Ooh, yeah. so I'm not going to go into all the details. You can just read the source code yourself. But let me say a couple of things about it. First, in vector product steps such as this one, I don't update the value of f in place, but rather store the result of the multiplication in a scratch vector and then swap pointers. Secondly, rather than computing 6 products and 3 sums, I compute this vector product in 3 fused steps that are most succinctly summarized by this expression, or this animation. With all of these optimizations in place, can you guess how far we can get? Sheesh! Without even whipping out any advanced algorithms, our fast exponentiation algorithm brings us past the 2 millionth Fibonacci number. For comparison and reference, this is precisely the same order of magnitude as the silver medalist in the original video, which used fast exponentiation of 2x2 matrices coupled with multiplications based on the fast Fourier transform. While this might make you think, wow, C is so much faster than C++, the more correct reaction is actually, wow, G is so much worse at programming in C++. By reducing generality, we reduce the memory requirement of our fast exponentiation algorithm by 25%. If we keep specializing, we can reduce the memory requirements even more. The box product on 3-dimensional vectors we defined is just the image of the matrix product on symmetric 2x2 matrices. In particular, it's a sensible product on all 3-dimensional vectors. But we're not interested in arbitrary 3-dimensional vectors. We're only interested in those vectors whose elements are consecutive Fibonacci terms. In particular, such vectors live in a 2-dimensional subspace consisting of vectors whose third component is the sum of the previous two. If we take our box product on 3-dimensional vectors and restrict it to this 2-dimensional subspace, we get the following stranger-looking product. Breaking this 2-dimensional product similarly into 3 fused computation steps, we can see very clear improvements in performance, and our 67% memory footprint brings us up to just over 2 million again. Given our 1-second cutoff, cheap shots at the hidden coefficient in the big O like this isn't going to take us very far, especially since our algorithm takes quadratically larger hits at subsequent powers of 2. The obvious next thing to do would be to simply replace the multiplication algorithm with one of the other fancy algorithms I discussed in the first video, but I don't really feel like doing that right now. Instead, let's flip our fast exponentiation algorithm onto its head. Fast exponentiation takes advantage of the binary representation of an exponent, which it recovers bit by bit, starting from the least significant bit. However, we can build the same thing from the top down, starting with the most significant bit and iteratively squaring the Fibonacci vector we're actually interested in, only multiplying the original transition vector at every set bit we encounter. The overall expression is admittedly a lot less pretty when written out like this, but this form of fast exponentiation has some noteworthy advantages, which we can see from the pseudocode. Unlike the original fast exponentiation algorithm, we don't need to iteratively square the transition vector A, which means that our transition steps are much cheaper. In fact, expanding out the box product, we don't even need any multiplications to perform this step. After all, it's just advancing the Fibonacci sequence by 1. Secondly, the only non-trivial box product is a squaring operation, which means that we don't need 2 buffers for arguments and 1 for the result. We can instead get away with just 2 buffers in total. Moreover, our strange box product simplifies quite nicely and naturally breaks into 2 few steps rather than 3. But gee, you might be saying, this is still a quadratic time algorithm. These are still just cheap shots at the hidden coefficient in the big O. While you're definitely right that this is still an O of n squared algorithm, well, I don't think words are necessary in this case. Hacking away at the constant factor brought us a smidge over the 4 millionth Fibonacci number. Now that our accumulation step for each set bit of the index is effectively just an addition, we no longer have noticeable jumps in the runtime at every power of 2, which also means that incremental improvements are back in business. This simple implementation brings us neck and neck with the gold medalist C++ implementation in our first video. This is exciting for many reasons. For one thing, it's only going to get better from here. We've already explored much more efficient multiplication algorithms, and assuming I don't completely fumble their implementations again, the neuron activation from making big numbers fast is going to be crazy. Already matching my top C++ implementation also brings other good tidings. First, it means C++ is no longer going to be the punchline of my YouTube thumbnails. Secondly, it means that we can finally retire the exhausted jokes about how the YouTuber whose name is partially inspired by the GNU C++ compiler is trash at writing good C++. If you have unsaid jokes in this regard, you'll have to get them out in the comments section now, before the joke becomes irrelevant in later videos. Anyway, if you're still here, thank you for watching. If you liked what you watched, or the implications of what you watched, I believe YouTube has mechanisms in place to express that somehow. If you didn't like what you watched, it's fine. Although I often write code that drags down my reputation, there will always be at least one source of wind beneath my wings.